Like you said, I'm talking today about using Phoenix, I'm sorry, using Ecto outside of Phoenix. And I know that a lot of people, when they get started with Elixir, they kind of hear from it by Phoenix or maybe hear it some other way. But I know I heard about Phoenix early on when I was learning about Elixir. But I thought I wanted to not learn Phoenix quite yet until I was pretty proficient in Elixir. So I went out and looked for ways to do that. And one of the ways I like to learn things is to use a database. A lot of the things I do are backed by data. A lot of the things you guys do are backed by data. And if I could code up something as I'm learning that interacts with data, then that helps me in my learning process. And so that's why I decided to go ahead and start learning Ecto, even though I hadn't learned Phoenix yet, in order to start doing that kind of data manipulation and storing things and retrieving things from the database, even ones that have already been created. So interacting with databases that maybe are legacy databases. So that's kind of what we're going to talk about today. First of all, I work for a company called Planning Center. I realize today I'm kind of a walking, you can't see it because I'm short, but I'm kind of a walking billboard for Planning Center. I even got socks on from Planning Center. That's not necessarily on purpose, it's just they happen to provide like 3/4 of my wardrobe at this point, which I'm very thankful for. Anyway, we make apps for churches. Very fun place to work. We love what we do. We love our churches. We love our apps, and we love the people who work with us and our customers. So check us out. It's just at planning.center. They're based in Carlsbad, California, which is just north of San Diego. And for the past 9 years, up until a year ago, I lived in Arkansas. It was my second stint in Little Rock in my life. And decided to move. I was remote there, and I decided to move out to San Diego to be close. And personal information, but my family and I in Little Rock, one of the things we'd like to do is go out to eat, and we'd always go get fajitas at this, you know, one or two specific places. We love fajitas. And so we thought, okay, San Diego, right next to the border, it's going to have awesome Mexican food and great fajitas, and we've had the hardest time finding fajitas. We cannot find fajitas. And people are always, I was like, where's the good fajitas? Where's the good fajitas? And they're like, well, we don't have fajitas. That's like Tex-Mex. I was like, oh, really? Okay, well, if you say so. So last night I had fajitas. I was very excited to come to Texas and have fajitas again. Yeah, so first of all, what is Ecto? Ecto is a domain-specific language for writing queries and interacting with databases in Elixir. And that's one of two times I'm going to directly quote documentation. So this is the most exciting part of the talk. I'm just going to read straight for the docs. Basically, it helps you write queries that interact with your database. It's crazy how that's actually the case. So it provides a few different things. First of all, it provides powerful change sets, and we're going to get into that in a little bit. Another thing it provides is composable queries. You can actually build up your query over a number of different functions if you wanted to, based on either user input or some other determinations. It's got connection pooling built in, so if something goes down, automatically ring back up the connection to the database. It's got database migrations, so you can track the schema of your database over time, so you can put that into Git or whatever you're using for version control, and see how that changes over time. And if you need to, you can roll that back or bring that back up in different environments. It also has some built-in security because it does some escaping and things like that that you may not think of writing straight SQL. And also it has flexibility. So if you need to write straight SQL, it has that ability. It's got something called fragment. You can write SQL fragments if you need to and just pipe that straight into the database. So this is actually this is like the end of the slides. I've got maybe two more. This is mostly live coding, so it's going to be very interesting. Hopefully everything works okay. I will tell you I'm going to make a few mistakes on purpose, and I'll probably make a few mistakes not on purpose. I'll leave you to guess which ones are which. Our goal today is going to be to set up Ecto in a brand new application and start using it a little bit. So we'll set it up. We'll create a to-do application. That seems to be the thing to do. And we're not going to have like a command line interface. We're not going to have a web GUI. It's just basically all in IEX. So nothing crazy beautiful. It's just super simple, ready to just get you guys interested in Ecto. So the goal is to get you kind of pique your interest in Ecto and say, well, if he can do that quickly, maybe that's something I want to look into for things we're working on and go from there. One thing I did forget to mention is there are different adapters for Ecto that you can use depending on your database. So the default is Postgres. They've also got a MySQL one. They recently released version 2. Ecto was recently upgraded to version 2. And version 1 actually still has support for MS SQL, MongoDB, and SQLite 3. So that hasn't been updated yet to version 2, I don't think. But those may be coming. All right, so let's do some mix new, right? Let's exit this. And let me know if you guys cannot see things. But I'm going to go from here. All right, so we go mix new. One of the things I like about Elixir is that it provides you with good help documentation. Documentation is like a first-class citizen in Elixir, which is really cool. So if you make a mistake, it usually tells you good examples of how to correct that mistake. So in this case, it says, hey, I expected a path to be given. Please use mix new path. So another thing you can do is ask it for help. So we can say mix help new. And it's a little small here. I'm going to back it out just a little bit for now. But you can see it provides you with examples of how to use mix new. It provides you with the different options you can use. And I'm going to point out one option that we're going to use today, and that's the dash dash sup option. It says it can be given to generate an OTP application skeleton, including a supervision tree. So we're going to be using Ecto, and it's going to have that connection pooling. We want to make sure that we provide that option so we have that skeleton. We can write it all ourselves if we wanted to, but it's just nice to have that that skeleton already built for us. So I'm going to say mix new to do, and then pass that dash dash sup. All right, so we've generated our files for our Elixir application. It even says, you know, go cd test and then mix test. So cd to do, mix test. Let's do that. So cd to do, mix test. We got two tests already. We're already on our way, right? That's sweet. We didn't even write anything. Those are basically just testing that true is true. So we know that everything is working correctly in our basic application. I'm actually going to start a TMUX session here. Pardon the horribly looking status bar there. I usually do it in black and other colors. So from here, we need to edit some files. The first thing we need to do is go into, let me go to ElixirConf, to do, and we need to open up mix.exs. And in here, we can define our dependencies. So if we go down here to deps, we need to add two dependencies for application. One is Ecto itself. So I'll type in Ecto here, and we're going to make sure that it's around 2.1. And then we're also going to bring in something called Postgres. And this is basically the database adapter for Postgres. It's the default adapter for Ecto. It's what I have installed running right now locally, and so it's easy to use. If you're using MySQL, the dependency package for that is MariaX. And of course, there's other ones as well. You can look at the Ecto site to find those dependencies. But we need to do that. We no longer, in Elixir 1.4, we need to define it in our applications because it infers that based on our dependencies. So it'll spin up those applications when it spins up ours, which is really cool. So now that we have those defined, we can see, go back to our command line, mix.deps.get, and it'll go out and get those dependencies for us. Cool, we're done. No, I'm just kidding. What I want to do now is mix compile. So one of the dependencies it got was Ecto, of course. And one of the things that Ecto provides are some helper tasks for mix that we can use to get our application running. So if you had looked in just straight mix help before we ran this, you would have noticed there were no Ecto options. But as it's compiling this, we're now going to get those Ecto options. I know the first time I tried this, I did mix deps.get, and I looked in the mix help, and there were no Ecto options. And I was like, I added it to my dependencies. Why isn't it there? Well, that's because I haven't compiled it yet. So make sure you compile before you do this so you can see these. So if you say mix help, and I'm just going to grep out our Ecto options here, now we can see that we have a few different helpers, which is really cool. The first thing we need to do is create something called a repository. And that is basically what interacts with your database in your application. And it actually provides us something, mixecto.gen.repo generates a new repository. So let's try that, mixecto.gen.repo. And again, we have a good error message here. It says it couldn't find repositories for application. But we could do that on the command line by passing it the dash r option. And what dash r expects is a module name for our application, for our repository. So let's say mixecto.gen.repo, do dash r, and we're just going to call our repo to do.repo. All right, it generated a few files for us, and we'll go take a look at those here in a second. But it actually, again, provides us with some helpful tips. It says, don't forget to add your new repo to your supervision tree, typically in lib/todo.ex. So I'm just going to copy this supervisor, and I'm going to go into my editor here. Go to lib/todo.ex, and what is actually changed? I don't know if Ecto hasn't updated this quite yet, because Elixir 1.4 changed where this lives by default, but that's a little misleading. So if it still says that when you're watching this or you're trying this on your laptop and it's not there, it's actually going to be in todo/application. So in here, we want to add our supervisor under our children, okay? So when our application starts up, it'll start supervising our repo. Perfect, so that step is done. If we go back, it also says, and to add it to the list of Ecto repositories in your configuration files. So Ecto tasks work as expected. I would like for them to work as expected, so let's config that. I'll copy that and go into config.exs. And I'll say, we also want to config our to-do application with what it provided me. Perfect. Now, in here, you'll also see that it has provided some defaults, some initial things that connect to the database that you told it you wanted to use, in this case, Postgres. It says, you know, we're using a Postgres adapter. If we were using MariaX, this would go to the MySQL adapter. Has the database name and our username and password. So these are some things you're probably going to need to change. So I'm going to change those for my local thing. Everybody close your eyes. All right, open them. I don't want you to know my password. Okay, so that's done. We're done with setting up our database. That's all we needed to do. So as long as Postgres is running, if we do mix ecto.create, we should create our database successfully. So it's going to compile those files we changed. It's going to give us a saying. It says generated to-do app and the database for to-do.repo has been created. So we got hooked up correctly, right? So the Postgres was running. It now has a database named, whatever I gave it in the config. I forgot to change that. It's to-do repo. Perfect. So the next thing, we need to actually add a module. So we need to actually add the things that we want to store in this database. So since this is a to-do application, one of the first things we need to do is add a to-do item, right? So let's create an item module. So we go to lib to-do, and we'll create a file item.ex. So we're going to def module to-do.item, and in there, we're going to use ecto.schema. Now what that'll do is it'll bring in some functions, some macros that will allow us to define how we want item to look like in our database or to our database. So to use that, to define that, we use schema. And it expects the table name of where it can find these items. So in this case, I'm just going to say it's in items. And then within that, we're going to define a few things. First, we're going to find a field. And our first field is going to be a title. And it's going to be a string. And they're also going to have a completed. And that's going to be a Boolean. Ecto also provides this handy function, timestamps, that basically automatically adds inserted at and updated at to your schema. So you don't have to type those out, because it realizes that most of the time you're going to want those. Also, I want to point out that if we had not specified string there in that field, it would have defaulted to string. But I like to be explicit and specify that. So now that we have our schema defined, the database still doesn't know about items, right? We haven't told it to create an items table. We haven't added any fields or columns to an items table. And to do that, we need what's called a migration. So let's go back into our terminal here. And we have another task that is that helps you create migration. So mix ecto gen migration. And it expects the name of the migration. So in this case, since we're creating our items table, I'm going to say create items. It's going to create a default file here for us with a little bit of boilerplate that we can use to use it in our migration. And that's in our priv repo migrations folder. So let's go check that out and edit that. I'm going to back out here. So we go down to priv repo migrations. And it timestamps it nicely, too, so you know exactly how your database is built up over time. Let's open that up. So in here, you can see that it uses ecto.migration, which provides a lot of the functionality we're going to use. And it has this change method. And Ecto is really cool in that it knows how to go back and forth on your migration. So if you're going one direction, it'll make changes. And if you go the other direction, if you need to roll those back for some reason, it'll actually be smart enough to know how to reverse those most of the time. Now, if you have some crazy migrations that you can't really predict what's going to happen up and down, you can write separate up and down functions. So if we wanted to do that, we can say def up and def down. In this case, we're not going to write anything crazy, so we're just going to let Ecto do its thing and just do everything inside the def change function here. So I'm actually going to bring up on the side here. Actually, let's do it below because of size. Let's bring up our items. So let's look at our schema as we create our table here. So inside the change, we're going to say our change is going to be create a table named items. And within there, we're going to add a field called title, and it's going to be a string. And we're also going to add completed, which is a Boolean. And we're going to add those timestamps. So in this case, our schema in our item module and our migration are like exactly the same almost. But that's because this is the first time we're messing with that items. In later migrations, which we'll see here in a minute, it won't match this exactly. It'll just start building it up over time. I'm going to close this side. And we will run that. So we say mix ecto migrate. And it'll run that migration. So you can see it's running our create items migration, the change function, and it's going forward. And it created the table items. And it did that in a whopping 0.0 seconds. So glad we had to wait for that. All right, so the next thing we want to do is let's try it out, right? Let's see if we can interact with our database in the items table. So I'm going to bring up an IEX session here, which is going to be our best friend for a while. I'm going to alias a couple things here to make my typing a little less stressful. So we've aliased repo and item. So one first thing I want to do is do this. Now, if you are familiar with Elixir, you're like, wait a minute, he didn't define a struct. But if I press enter here, we have a struct defined for us. And that's another one of the cool things that Ecto does for us. It actually provides us with a struct automatically that we can use in our application. So it knows that we've got a completed field, we've got an inserted at, title, updated at, but what the heck is this ID field here? We didn't tell anything about ID. Well, thankfully, Ecto is also smart enough to know that usually you're going to want something like an ID field. Now, if you want to avoid that, you can tell it skip the ID field completely. You can say, you know what, I want my items field, my primary key to be called to-do ID for whatever reason. Then you can do that. You can override those settings. But by default, it's going to create an ID field for you, which is pretty cool. Now, to insert an item, which sounds like something you want to do, we will say repo. Actually, let's see all the items in our database right now. So we can say repo.all and then pass in item. We do that. A couple cool things. First of all, it shows us some debug information. In this case, the source of this query is the items table. And it's 1.2 milliseconds in the database. And then it actually points out or prints out the SQL that it generated based on what I told it that it sent to Postgres to actually get these items. And finally, we have the result of that, which in this case is an empty list, which is what we'd expect because we haven't put anything in there yet. So let's put something in. So let's say repo.insert, and we're going to create an item, and let's say the title is my first item. All right, so again, we have the debug output. This is the SQL it generated, and it returns back a tuple of OK in this case because it was OK, and then also the record that it provided. In this case, we have our to-do item. So if you wanted to, you can pattern match on that. So let's pretend like I did that, and we'll say, in case you don't know, V is actually the return of the last statement in IEX, so it's super helpful if you've got, oh man, I forgot to pattern match that, I wanted to capture that item. Well, you can do that, and now we have item in our capture. Okay, so now we have our item, perfect. It's got an ID of one, it's got our inserted at, it's got my title, but the completed is nil. Now, if you have a to-do application, nil doesn't really mean much to you, right? It's either true or false, really. You can kind of say, well, if it's false or nil or falsy, but we want to make sure that it's either true or false. So let's add a default to that, okay? So we go back into our item module, and on this field, on our completed field here with Boolean, we can say default is going to be false. Let's save that. Go back into our IEX. Let's recompile our item module. And let's insert a new item. Let's say item 2 equals repo.insert. And I'm going to use this bang method, which actually returns not a tuple of OK and then the item, but just the item that it inserted itself. So we don't have to pattern match on it. We're going to insert an item, and the title is going to be my second item. OK, so now we can see that completed is false, even though we didn't provide it with any information as to what to do with completed. And since we didn't do that, it defaulted to false, which is exactly what we wanted. But now we have this to-do out there that's still nil, right? We forgot to do that on our first creation. Maybe you put this out on the web, and you've got 100 to-dos now that have completed as false. And that's not cool. You want to fix that. So let's modify that. Let's update that particular record so that the completed at is false. So there's a couple different ways we can get something from the database. The first is get by. And so we can say we want to get an item, and we're going to search for it by the title. And I think I called it my first item. So let's just do that. So it's going to search the database, select, you can see here in the database, items where the title is my first item. And so we get back this item here. And again, I forgot to capture it, so I'm going to go ahead and do that. We can see this is the one that has completed nil. Now, if you are familiar with Elixir, you realize that to update a map, one cool way to do it is to kind of open up the map syntax here, put in your item, and then a pipe, and then what you want to update. So let's say completed is false. So if I do that, we can see we get back one where completed is, in fact, false. So you think, perfect, let's use that and update our repo with that information. So we'll say repo.update, feeling all confident, and go here, item, and we're going to pipe in completed is actually false. Uh-oh, here's an error. Thankfully, this is one I was expecting. It says, giving a struct to todo.repo update is not supported. Ecto is unable to properly track changes. When a struct is given, an Ecto change set must be given instead. So this is one of those things I mentioned that's really cool about Ecto, is that you have these things called change sets. And this is the second most exciting part where I'm going to read from documentation, so hold on to your seats. Change sets allow filtering, casting, validation, and definition of constraints when manipulating structs. Ecto change sets provide both validations and constraints, which are ultimately turned into errors in case something goes wrong. Now that's pretty cool. That's pretty powerful. You can see things, like in the Programming Phoenix book, one of the things that they do is, in a change set, they'll actually take a plain text password and hash that password before it actually puts it into the database. And that's done inside a change set. You can do other things like validate certain fields are a certain length or match a certain thing. You can call your own custom functions that that will validate that true or false. So let's create a change set, because we do want to update that item. So back in our items here, we're going to import ecto.changeset. And we're going to create a function called changeset here. Now it's going to expect an item struct, and it's also going to expect some params, but we're going to give it an empty map as a default here. And within there, we're going to take that item and pipe that directly into a function called cast. And it's going to say, within the params, I'm going to allow two fields here. I'm going to allow title and completed to actually pass through my check. So if you had some field that you didn't want to go through in your change sets, let's say you had something you never wanted to have change, then you can exclude that from your allowed list here, and that would never get through to your database as long as you use that change set. So let's use that. So let's recompile our item, and let's get our item again. Actually, let's do it a different way. So I can say item. This is another way to get something from your repo. Repo.get item with the ID of 1. And that'll give us that first item with our ID of 1, the one that is completed nil. So if we look at item.changeset, and initially, for illustration purposes, I'm just going to pass it an empty item, and I'm going to say my changes are going to be title something. Let's look at what it gives us back. First of all, it gives us this struct, ecto.changeset, and it has this changes attribute, which title is something. So it knows that we're trying to change what we passed it, which was initially empty. We're trying to change title into something. So far, it has no errors because we didn't provide any in the change set. We weren't doing any validations. It provides us the data, which actually is what we passed it. And it checks if it's valid. It returns if it's valid. And you can pattern match on that to see if the things that you're trying to do are valid. It'll actually keep it from going into the database if it's invalid, which is really cool. But we can use this. And let's use this to update that first item where our completed at is nil. So we can say item.changeset. Change set, item, and we want to change completed to false. And we're going to pipe that directly into repo.update. So we can see here, it did update items. It set completed to false. And it gave us back this tuple again, which, again, I forgot to pattern match. So let me do that. Item equals V. Okay, so now we have our updated item with completed false. Perfect. That's what we wanted. So now we've got that. Let's go ahead and start adding users and tying these items to users. So first, I need to go back and create a user module here. So I'll say user.ex. Whoop, not UEX. User.ex. And def module. To do. Man. Dot user do. And we're also going to use ecto.schema in here. And our schema here is going to be super simple. It's going to be users. We're going to have a field called name, and that's going to be a string, and let's go ahead and add our tab stamps because they're fun. Now, a user in our database, in our application, is going to have many items. So the items are going to belong to a user. And that's something we can also define in our schema here. So we can say has many items, and it's going to expect on the second thing where it can find the definition of an item. So in this case, it's in our item module. We'll save that. Let's go back over to our item, because it's now going to belong to a user. So it say belongs to a user, and you can find that defined in todo.user. So we have user defined as a schema. We have our item updated to know that it belongs to a user, but we don't have those changes in the database yet. So what do we need? Everybody, yes, migration, right? So let me split this real quick, because I don't want to get rid of it. So I'm going to say mix ecto.gen.migration. We're going to create users. We have that now, that file, so let's go edit that. Again, I'm going to go back to my user and split my screen here so you can kind of see how we're doing this. And go to priv, repo, migrations, and then our create users migration. And again, we're going to create a table user, table users. And we're going to add a field called name. It's going to be a string. And we're going to say it has, no, it doesn't have many. We're going to do our timestamps. Because the database doesn't care about the has many. It cares about the belongs to. If you know, databases usually have the belongs to, the foreign ID is going to be on the belongs to field side. So we want to say that the items table should have a user ID field, right? A user ID column. So within that same migration, we can actually alter a table. So we're going to alter table items. And we're going to add a user ID column. And it references users. Perfect. You can add as many different things in one migration as you want. Sometimes it's better to split them up. Sometimes it's better to put them together. So it's kind of up to you as to how you want to split those up. In this case, I'm just going to keep them together. So we'll go back, and if I do mix ecto.migrations, it'll list out all the different migrations we've created and their status. So we can see here, we've got create items. It's been migrated. We also have create users now, and it's down right now. So we want to migrate that up. So we can say mix ecto.migrates. All right, so we've created our table users, and we've altered our table items. Perfect. I'm going to close that because I don't need it anymore. I'm going to recompile item, and I'm going to alias to do.user. And let's create a user. So repo.insert, I'm going to do a bang. I'm going to say user with the name of, let's just do me, Geo. All right, so now we've got a user in our database. And you can see here it's got an ID, it's got inserted at, and it has items now. So it knows that we have a group of items that it's expecting in the database to be based off of this particular user, which is really cool. At this point, I'm going to go and show you how to delete something, because there's not really a better time. So let's say we messed that up somehow, we want to delete that. So I'm going to say repo.get the first user, and let's pipe that directly into repo.delete. So that's how you delete something. Super simple. Just put in what you want to delete, and it'll delete it from the database. Doesn't need to change that. You can do it that way. But we actually do want a user in our database, so let's add a user back. So I'm going to say geo equals repo.insert, bang, user with the name of geo. All right, cool. So there I am. I'm in the database. Now, if you're familiar with Rails, I come from the Rails world, and I liked Active Record because I could go, you know, user.items, and it would load up all the items for me, which is really cool. So and maps are kind of the same way in Elixir. So if I say geo.id, we get the ID of 2. Perfect. If I say geo.inserted at, let's just do name, faster type, we get geo. That's what we wanted. So let's try geo.items. Items is not loaded. So this is one of the cool things about Ecto that I like as well, in that it makes you be kind of explicit about what you actually want loaded from the database at the time you're doing those database loads. You can load it later if you wanted to, but I like that it makes you load it explicitly, because there are a lot of times in Rails where you get into N+1 queries and other, you know, slowness because of so many database calls. Well, this makes it where you have to think about that from up front and actually specify that in your code, which is really cool. So if we wanted to, we can say, we're going to preload it. So I can say geo equals repo.preload me, I'm going to preload, items. So now if I say geo.items, I get an empty list. So it's preloaded that from the database for us, which is kind of what we wanted. Perfect. So let's make the second, or the first item, let's associate that with me, right? Let's update the item ID to me. So we have our item. And you can see that it has a, well, it doesn't right now. So item equals repo get our first item again. So now we can see that an item has a user ID field. And it's nil right now. So let's update that to a user ID of 2, which is going to be me. So again, we can say repo.update, bang. And we're going to pass in our item and our changes that we want. We want to say user ID is 2. That messed up. Let me change that real quick. Update. Item user, because I don't have to change set. Item.change set, that's gonna go out here. Item.change set. This is totally one I planned for, right? Let's try that. Okay, so we have a successful database back and forth, and it returns the item. But wait a minute, our user ID is still nil. Why is that? Well, if remember, in our change set, we had to explicitly whitelist the things we wanted to allow changed in our database. And since we didn't have that in the database, we couldn't make the mistake of updating this without being explicit. Another cool thing about Ecto and Elixir, in my opinion, that you have to be explicit a lot of times. When I first got into it, I was like, I gotta write so much, it's so annoying, gotta be so explicit about everything. But now I'm like, it saved my butt so many times. So let's go in here and allow the user ID to be changed. And let's go try that again. So let's recompile our item, and now let's try that update. Now we have a user ID of 2. Perfect. So we have to allow those changes through in our whitelist and our change set. Okay, cool. So we got about 15 minutes left. Two things I want to do. One is let's create a new item with the association already created, and then I'm just going to go through some different queries you can do in Ecto and to kind of show some of the power of the querying. So the first thing I'm going to do is create a new item. Ecto has this thing called build a sock. That basically builds an association between two things that are already associated, but it'll build the association for you. So in this case, let's build an associated item. So for me, I want to build an association of items, and the title is, let's say, speak at Lonestar ElixirConf. So we can see here, it's built something for us. It already has a user ID of 2, which is going to associate with me, and we can pipe that directly into our repo.insert. And now we've got an associated item in the database with that one call, which is pretty fun. All right, now some querying. Let's get into some querying. First, before we do that, I'm going to go a little quick here and create a new column just to add some fun data that we can query. I'm going to add in our items a new field called estimated minutes. And this is just to track how long we think something's going to take. And it's going to be an integer. And we need to create a migration for that. So let's bring back up, split this again, mix ecto.gen.migration, add estimated minutes to items. All right, let's go back over here, load that file up. It's going to be in priv, repo, migrations, and we're going to alter table, items, and not odd, do. We're going to add a field of estimated minutes, and it's going to be an integer. Close that. That's all we're doing in that migration. So let's migrate that. Mix ecto.migrate. Cool. So now we have estimated minutes in our items table. Next thing I want to do is just add a bunch of random data. Bear with me for a second while I do this. Let's say we're going to add 75 things in there. So let's pipe that into enum.each and to get the index of that. For that function, we're going to create an item with the title of to-do number I. And it's going to be estimated minutes. We're just going to make a random number here, random between, uniform. Say between 1 and 120, or 0 and 120. And a user ID is going to be also random between, let's do it this way, 2 and 3. And you should notice that we don't have a user ID of 3, which will come into effect here in a second. User ID, and then completed, it's also going to be random between true and false. And we're going to close that and then pipe that into repo.insert, the bang, and in that. So you can see here, it gives us this long thing, but what we wanted to see is that the key, did I misspell it? Estimated minutes, not found. Estimated minutes, item. Estimated minutes. No, I did. Well, I didn't do a recompile. Thank you. All right, well, I'll just tell you real quick what the user ID of 3 would have done. It would have given us an error for that because it realized in the database that we don't have a user ID of 3, which is one of those cool constraints because we told it that that column is going to be referencing the user's table on the ID column, which is pretty neat. But I'm going to pass that for now. So ID, I'll just go back and do that. Tap that into repo.insert and that. And now we can't do that. Oh, put that 3 in there again. So this is the thing I was just telling you was going to happen. I forgot to add the user. So let's add the user. Repo.insert. I'm going to add another user. In this case, I don't really care. Let's just say repo insert user with the name of Max. Okay, now we've got user ID of 3. Let's try that one more time. Pipe that into the each. And then go to the item, and then pipe that into insert, and then we'll end that. You're kidding. Let's see. Parentheses are required. There you go. Thank you. My up game was wrong. Title. I'm just going to do that into repo.insert and then end that. Thank you. Okay, so now I've got random data in our database, finally. So let's ask it how many are in there. So earlier we were using repo.all. That's just to give us everything back. It's expecting one or more results, or zero or more results. Now repo.1 is expecting at most one result. So we can say repo.1, and say from I in items, or item, we want to select the count of I.id. I do this a lot. And we need to import our ecto.query. That'll give us those functions. So we can see we have 79 items in our database. 75 from those tests we did, and a few from our initial ones. So we can say, well, how many belong to the user max? So we can do that. So repo.1 from I in item. And this is just setting up our variables, saying we were looking for something in the items table. And we're going to say that we're going to reference that as I. And we're going to join that with you in user on i.userid equals u.id. And we're going to say where the u.name equals max. And we're going to select the count of his IDs. So he has 38 items in the database. You can see here that with that, it provided this SQL, which is kind of cool. So I didn't write any SQL. I kind of have to know a little bit about database transactions to write this. But I didn't have to write any SQL. So if at some point we needed to switch from Postgres to MySQL or to MSSQL or whatever, we just plug in a different adapter and Ecto would do that for us, which is really neat. Let's do something else. Let's say how many belong to each one of us. So we can say repo.all from I in item, join you in user on i.userid equals u.id where, group by. And we're going to group by the user ID, and we're going to select. And this is something cool about Ecto, too. You can actually tell it how you want the data back. So you can do that in select. So if I didn't tell it specifically in select what I wanted, it would provide all the different full structs of the records that we are looking for. In this case, all I want is, let's say, in a map, I want the count and i.id. And I also want something in name, so u.name. And I want them in maps. So you can see it returns a list of maps for us. With the count and the name of the person they belong to, which is pretty neat. So we can also ask, well, what are the easy ones? So let's say we want to search for ones that are under 10 minutes long. So you can say repo.all from I, and how many times do I have to write this? Well, let's just see something easy here. Let's create a query. This is where the composable queries comes in. So if we have that we know we're going to be typing in from I in item, join you in user, we can actually store that in a variable. And then from that point later on, use that variable as the starting point for any other later transactions we want to do. So let's do that. So let's say our query is going to be from I in item, not in an item, I in item. We're going to join up with the u in user on i.userid equals u.id. All right, so that's all we wanted to do. So we've got that query now. You can see that it's returned a query for us. We can pass this variable around. We can add to it. We can modify it. We can do what we need to do to build up the query over time, which is where the composable part of Ecto comes in. So now we can say repo.all from I and U in our query. So here we're saying the I is going to refer to the first thing we defined, which is the I in item. And I can name this whatever I wanted. I can name this the first thing. But for now, I'm just going to name it I to keep from typing. And the U is the second thing, which is the user. In query, we were going to select the easy ones. So we can say where estimated minutes of our item is less than 10. And let's order by the estimated minutes. And let's select in a map, we'll say the to-do title is going to be i.title, our item title. Let's say the time is going to be i.estimated minutes. And our user, let's put in our username. So there we go. We've got the things that are easy things to do. So I've got this one here. It's only 1 minute. Let's just get it done, right? It's to-do number 59. Perfect. That's what I wanted to do anyway. So this kind of gives you a demonstration of different things you can do. You can pass an order by. You can pass in different searches here. So in the past, we've just done equals. We can do less than. We can do greater than. We can specify different returns. So let's say instead of in that map, we wanted everything in a tuple here. So let's say we just want the title and then the estimated minutes and then the user. So now we get it all back in just straight tuples, which is really cool. Let's say we want them in lists. Well, we can say, let's put that in a list. And Ecto will provide that to us in a list. So Ecto is really flexible in providing you exactly the data you need in the format that you need it, which is really cool. So if you have some web view or something you're using in Phoenix or some other app, you can actually say, I want these things with these names and a map and all this kind of stuff, and it'll actually provide that to you right away. So you don't have to modify it later. Pretty neat. A couple other things I want to try. Let's do this. Let's say, let's do one more. So it can actually use the power of the database itself to do some calculations and do some things that the databases can sometimes do. So let's get the average minutes for each user. So we can say from repo.all, from, in this case, I'm just going to type out I have an user in our query. We're going to group our query by our user ID, and we're going to select the user, user.name, and let's say our to-dos, let's get our count, item.id, and average minutes. And here we're going to use the average function, which again, Ecto will take and pipe that directly into Postgres, so we don't have to, Elixir doesn't have to do anything about it. Postgres will do all that for us. Our item, estimated minutes. Oh, darn it. Does anyone know how to stop that? Let me redo this. Repo, user, item, and I think that was it. So let's try that again. Repo.all. We're going to have to rewrite that from I in item, join you in user, on i.user id equals u.id, group by user.id, we're going to select, this is what I forgot earlier. For some reason, the select is the only one I always forget the colon on. We're going to select user, u.name, to-dos, our counts, i.id, and average minutes is going to be our average, average of our I estimated minutes. All right, let's see if that does it. It does not. Ah, thank you. Of course, import ecto.query, because I had to back out everything. All right, let's do that. User, oh, because I didn't do user, I did u this time. U.id. Okay, there we go. So now, you see Postgres did the averaging for us, as you can tell in our SQL here. It sent that straight to Postgres, and it averaged everything for us and gave us back the maps we were expecting on that. That's really all the time we have to go into some of those things, but Ecto has a whole lot more things that are really powerful that I'd really encourage you to go check out. I've maybe submitted one or two PRs into Ecto, so this isn't my repo. It's awesome. All I did was maybe correct a couple of typos, so you can thank me for that. Go check it out. It is amazing, and I know that for me, as I'm learning new things, again, databases are the way to go for me. I know some of you are probably the same. Also, for enterprise databases, I know someone was asking earlier about, you know, interacting with Oracle and maybe some big MS SQL databases. This can do that. Again, Ecto 1 would have to do that for MS SQL, and Oracle hasn't been written yet, but maybe that's on you, and go from there. But anyway, I blog at geoffreylessel.com. So far, it's like one post every other month or something like that, and I've always been on Elixir, and most of it's been on Ecto. And a lot of them, I go through how to build up different sample applications to show you different things to do with Ecto, including, you know, multiple repos with multiple databases of different types, dealing with legacy databases, that kind of stuff. So check that out if you're interested. Thank you very much.